When Mr. Herambiotis, the American minister, bought Canterville cheese, everyone told him he was doing a very foolish thing. There was no doubt that the place was haunted. Lord Canterville himself had felt it his duty to mention the fact to Mr. Otis before he bought the house. "We have not lived in the place since my great aunt went mad, when two skeleton hands were placed on her shoulders as she was dressing for dinner," said Lord Canterville. "I must tell you, Mr. Otis, that the ghost has been seen by several members of my family, as well as by the Reverend Augustus Dampier, a well-known man of the church. After the unfortunate accident to my aunt, none of the younger servants would stay with us, and Lady Canterville often got very little sleep at night because the strange noises that came from the corridor and library." Mr. Otis, however, laughed at these warnings and bought the house. A few weeks later, he and his wife, their son Washington, their daughter Virginia, and twin boys moved to Canterville Chase. When they arrived at the house, an old woman was standing on the steps to meet them. This was Mrs. Umney, the housekeeper, who had worked in the house for Lord and Lady Canterville. "Welcome to Canterville Chase," she said, and took them through the house to the library, where tea was waiting for them. After they had taken off their coats and hats, they sat down while Mrs. Umney poured the tea. Suddenly, Mrs. Otis caught sight of a dull red stain on the floor just by the fireplace. "I'm afraid something has been spilt there, Mrs. Umney," she said. "Yes, madam," replied the old housekeeper in a low voice. "Blood has been spilt on that spot." "How awful," cried Mrs. Otis. "I don't care at all for blood stains in a sitting room. It must be removed at once." The old woman smiled and answered in the same low, mysterious voice, "It is the blood stain of Lady Eleanor of Canterville, who was murdered on that very spot by her own husband, Sir Simon de Canterville, in the year 1575. Sir Simon disappeared 9 years later, and his body has never been found. His guilty ghost still haunts the chase. The bloodstain has been admired by visitors to the house, and it cannot be removed." "That is all nonsense," cried Washington Otis. "Pinkerton's stain remover and perfect cleaner will clean it up very quickly." Before the housekeeper could interfere, he had fallen on his knees and was rubbing the floor with a small black stick. In a few minutes, the blood stain had disappeared. "I knew Pinkerton's would do it," he cried, as he looked round at his admiring family. But as soon as he said these words, a terrible flash of lightning lit up the room. A fearful crash of thunder made them all jump to their feet, and Mrs. Umney fainted. In a few minutes, however, she was able to sit up. There was no doubt that she was very unhappy, and she warned Mr. Otis that trouble could come to the house. "I have seen things with my own eyes, sir," she said, "that would make your hair stand on end with fright. Many nights I have not been able to sleep for the awful things that are done here." Mr. and Mrs. Otis, however, told her that they were not afraid of ghosts, and she was at last went slowly out to her own room. The storm blew fiercely all that night. The next morning, when they came down to breakfast, they found the terrible stain of blood once again on the floor. "I don't think it can be the fault of the perfect cleaner," said Washington. "I have tried it with everything. It must be the ghost." He rubbed out the stain a second time, but the second morning it appeared again. It was there again on the third morning, though the library had been locked up all night by Mr. Otis himself, and the key taken upstairs. The whole family was now quite interested. That night they all went to bed at 11 o'clock, and by 11:30 all the lights were out. Sometime later, Mr. Otis was awakened by a curious noise in the corridor outside his room. It sounded like the rattle of metal and seemed to be coming nearer every moment. He got up at once, struck a match, and looked at the same time. The time, it was 1 o'clock. The strange noise still continued, and with it he heard the sound of footsteps. He put on his shoes, took a small bottle out of his case and opened the door. Right in front of him, he saw in the pale moonlight a terrible old man. His eyes were as red as burning fire. Long grey hair fell over his shoulders. His clothes were old-fashioned, dirty and ragged. Heavy chains hung from his wrists and ankles. "My dear sir," said Mr. Otis, "I really must insist on your putting some oil on those chains. I have brought you a small bottle of Tammany Rising Sun Oil. I shall be leaving it here for you by the bedroom candles, and will be happy to bring you some more if you need it." He put on the table and, closing his door, went back to bed. For a moment the Canterville Ghost stood quite still. Then he threw the bottle upon the polished floor and ran down the corridor, making low groaning noises and glowing green in the darkness. Just as he reached the top of the great oak staircase, a door opened. Two little children dressed in white appeared, and a pillow flew past his head. There was no time to be lost, so he disappeared through the wall, and the house became quiet. On reaching a small secret room, he leaned against a moonbeam to get his breath back. Never in all his 300 years of haunting had anyone been so rude to him. He thought of the Duchess, whom he had frightened badly as she stood before her mirror in her lace and diamonds. He thought of the 4 housemaids who had screamed when he had smiled at them through the curtain of one of the spare bedrooms. Then there was the man whose candle he had blown out as he was on his way from the library, and who had been ill ever since. Old Madam Tremulette, having woken up early one morning, saw a skeleton sitting in an armchair by the fire reading her diary. She had been in bed for 6 months with an attack of vein fever. He remembered the terrible night when the wicked Lord Canterville was found choking in his dressing room with a card halfway down his throat. He had confessed just before he died that he had cheated Charles James Fox out of £50,000 at cards by using that very card, and swore that the ghost had made him swallow it. All his great victories came back to him again. A servant had shot himself because he had seen a green hand tapping at the window. The beautiful Lady Stratfield had to wear a black velvet band round her neck to hide the marks of the 5 fingers burnt upon her white skin. She had drowned herself in the fish pond in the garden. He smiled as he remembered the fuss he had caused when he played 9 pins with his own bones on the lawn tennis ground. And now, after all this, some awful Americans had come and had offered him the Rising Sun Oil and had thrown pillows at his head. It was so awful. Besides, no ghost in history had ever been threatened in this manner. He was determined to have his revenge. The next morning, when the Otis family met at breakfast, they discussed the ghost for some time. The American minister was naturally annoyed. "I have no wish to do the ghost any harm," he said, "and I don't think it is at all polite to throw pillows at him, considering the length of time he has been in the house." Here, the twins burst into shouts of laughter. "But," continued Mr. Otis, "if he refuses to use the Rising Sun Oil, we shall have to take his chains away from him. It would be quite impossible to sleep with such noise going around." However, there was peace for the rest of the week. The only thing that happened was the continual reappearance of the bloodstain on the library floor. This certainly was very strange, as the door was locked at night by Mr. Otis and the windows kept closed bare. The changing color of the stain caused great excitement. Some morning it was dull red, then it would become brighter, then a rich purple. Once, when they came down for family prayers, they found it was bright green. These changes amused everyone very much, and they would all make guesses in the evening as to which color it would be the following day. The only person who did not think the stain was very funny was little Virginia. She, for some unexplained reason, was always upset at the sight of the blood stain, and nearly cried the morning it was green. The second appearance of the ghost was on a Sunday night. Soon after they had gone to bed, they were Suddenly frightened by a terrible crash in the hall. Rushing downstairs, they found that a large suit of old armor had come off its stand and had fallen on the stone floor. The Canterville ghost was sitting in a high backed chair, rubbing his knees with a look of great pain on his face. The twin had brought their pea shooters with them, and they shot at him. Mr. Otis pointed his gun at the ghost and told him to hold up his hands. The ghost jumped up with a wild scream of rage and swept through them like a cloud. He put out Washington Otis's candle as he went, leaving them in total darkness. When he reached the top of the stairs, he opened his mouth and laughed with his most horrible laughter ever, for which he was famous, until the walls shook. But he had hardly finished when a door opened and Mrs. Otis came out of her bedroom. She said, "I'm afraid you are not very well, and I have brought you a bottle of medicine. If you have stomach ache, you will find this very good for it." The ghost stared at her angrily. He was just about to turn himself into a big black dog when he heard footsteps as the twins came up to him. He disappeared with a deep groan. Hopefully you have liked this video. If yes, then please do click on that like button. Share this video with your friends and family on social media. And also don't forget to subscribe to this channel. I will see you soon in the next video. Do leave your request in the comments below. Thank you for watching. Bye.